Welcome to another episode of Disappeared Updates, where we cover every case previously featured on Investigation Discovery's hit television program, Disappeared. The goal of the series is to bring you any news and developments relevant to each case since the date of its original airing on the show. If there is no new information, then it will simply serve as a refresher and reminder of the case in hopes of spreading awareness and assisting in moving the case forward. Thank you for joining us.
If you enjoy true crime stories, please subscribe below and don't forget to click the notification bell to be alerted every time I upload a new video. Thank you.
Leah Peebles grew up in a well-to-do, Christian middle-class home in Fort Worth, Texas. In her earlier years, she is said to have been a good student at Riverside High School, getting good grades and being active in extracurricular activities such as cheerleading, drama club, and the yearbook staff. But trouble was bubbling beneath the surface in Leah's life. Her parents would later state that she was touched by a distant relative as a toddler, as well as an acquaintance at 14. By her sophomore year, she had begun abusing substances and alcohol and dropped out of her extracurricular activities. At 18 years old, Leah's parents put her in the Fort Worth Teen Challenge, a Christian residential treatment facility for women. Leah stayed in the program for 21 months and graduated from cosmetology school. Things were looking up, but unfortunately wouldn't last. She would end up serving two short jail sentences for offenses after returning to her old ways, and would eventually lose her job at a salon for being unreliable. Leah moved to Albuquerque, New Mexico on May 5, 2006, in hopes of turning her life around. Just 17 days later, on May 22nd, she left the home she was temporarily living in with friends to meet a man she had met at the Flying Star Cafe for a date. Leah was set to begin working at the cafe the following week. But after leaving for her date, she was never seen or heard from again. Her vehicle was later found abandoned. There have been reported sightings of Leah in the Albuquerque area, with witnesses claiming she was using the name Mia as a street worker under a man named Donald Sears, who went by AJ. When questioned by police, Sears claimed to have never heard of Leah. Despite the last credible sighting of Leah being in the fall of 2006, her father has made 11 trips around the country in search for her, under the belief she may have been sold to another man. His trips encompass Albuquerque, New Mexico, Phoenix, Arizona, in Las Vegas, Nevada. Unfortunately, Leah's father was killed in an accident in 2014 in South Dakota. His obituary lists Leah as having survived him. As of today, Leah's disappearance remains unsolved. Any tips on her whereabouts can be reported to the Albuquerque Police Department at 505-242-2677.
Amber Gerwick's case is a little weird. It aired in November of 2011. By then, she'd actually already been found and was well on the way to recovery. Amber went missing right around mid-April 2011. Found in early May. Found by herself. Went missing by herself. It's pretty open and shut. But the unique thing about this case is that the 3 weeks that she was gone, total amnesia. She doesn't know how she got where she ended up with the police officer in Juliet. Didn't know who she was either. And maybe that's because she didn't want to remember exactly who she was. You see, Amber had been cheating on her husband and was going through a nasty divorce. By her own admissions, she had abandoned her kids the day that she went missing because she planned to take her own life. The last thing that she remembered was going into a convenience store and not finding a particular ice cream that she wanted. Now, all of that aside, back to the November 14th air date. By then, Amber was well on the way to recovery. At that point, it was fleeting memories a little at a time. But fast forward to February-March of 2012, and as she described it, it was like living years in just a couple of days. And through all of this, Amber feels that she's gotten a new lease on life. She needed to discover who she is, not who she was, and use this unique opportunity to learn who she was truly meant to be. There's been a lot of back and forth throughout the years on this one. We're not really here to speculate on that, but if you have any opinions on this case, please feel free to let us know below.
Colleen Orsborn was 15 years old when she went missing from Daytona Beach on March 19, 1984. She had missed the bus and decided to ditch school. She was never seen or heard from again. 3 weeks later, a fisherman found the body of a young woman in a shallow grave in Orange County. But at the time, a medical examiner determined the body found was unrelated to Colleen. In 2001, the Orsborn family received what appeared to be a confession letter, but this letter was later determined to be a hoax. But in February of 2011, a medical examiner matched DNA off the jawbone of the remains to mitochondrial DNA from Colleen's sisters. The remains were determined to be of Colleen Orsborn. Colleen's disappearance has been linked to Christopher Wilder, who was thought to have killed 8 women between February and April of 1984. Wilder was killed in a police standoff in New Hampshire in 1984, less than a month after Colleen vanished. He remains a suspect in the disappearances of Elizabeth Kenyon, Tammy Leppert, Mary Opitz, and Rosario Gonzalez, among others.
On December 16th, the year 2000, Jerry Michael Williams, who we'll call Mike from here on out, was presumed to have gone missing on Lake Seminole, a popular fishing and hunting spot on the Florida-Georgia state line. Investigators were originally told that he'd visited the lake in order to do some duck hunting, and that he had possibly fallen out of the boat and drowned. After investigators and rescuers located Mike's boat, they performed an exhaustive search of the lake bed in order to find the body, and at that time it was the only occasion where no remains or a body had been discovered in a drowning death that occurred on the lake. In what would eventually be concluded as a small brain moment, investigators concluded that his body must have been eaten by alligators after waders in a jacket containing his hunting license were found in the lake 6 months later, and it was due to this discovery that Mike was declared legally dead following a petition by his widow, Denise. Denise would go on to marry Brian Winchester, a mutual friend who had helped her take out a large life insurance policy shortly before he disappeared. Now, it would take a couple years, about 4 to be exact, from constant pestering from Mike's family in order to reopen the case, especially after the alligator theory had been debunked. You see, alligators don't actually eat in cold weather. And, even if they had, it's rare that they wouldn't leave something behind. A hand? Foot? They certainly left his ID behind. Even more confusing was the fact that his waders were found in the area where the alligators had been resting. Mike had been an advocate of safety. He never wore his waders while riding his boat, and would only don equipment when he was getting ready to enter the lake. And adding to the idea that the waders had been planted after his death, the condition that they were found in were almost pristine, with no claw or bite marks on them to be seen. People had their theories. Investigators thought they knew what was up, but without Mike's body, no one knew for sure. Now, let's fast forward to 2017. It's October, and the Florida Department of Law Enforcement have received a tip about Mike's body, and under the guise of a training exercise, County Public Works employees would begin working 16-hour days digging 9-foot-deep holes in the mud at a corner of the lake, all while using dams and pumps to hold the water back. But on October 18th, the team of search dogs and officers had finally found his body sandwiched between plywood sheets, and due to how he had been buried, almost 100% of his bones had been recovered, and his clothing had been well preserved, allowing investigators to do DNA tests to match the remains to his mother's sample. It seemed like all the pieces were finally starting to come together for Mike's disappearance, and going by the 3 insurance policies that his former wife Denise had taken out on him, investigators were clearly onto something, and her days of happily spending that money were numbered, or perhaps they were already behind her. Although Michael had been killed the day before his anniversary with his wife, she had given up on their love 3 years before. Denise and Mike's best friend Brian Winchester had been seeing each other since 1997, and Denise had decided instead of going through a troubling divorce, the best way to get Mike out of the picture would be if he had a little accident at the bottom of a lake. And so, with Brian's help, they orchestrated his disappearance that would fool people for the next 17 years. But by 2012, the two of them would be separated. For reasons I'll put on screen because YouTube doesn't enjoy those words. And Denise would file for divorce by 2015. And as part of the divorce, Brian had to perform an appraisal on the house that the two of them had owned, with that love money they got at Mike's expense. So on August 5th, when it was due in 2016, Denise left the home to drive to her job at Florida State University. And while she was talking on the phone to her sister, she saw someone climb over the back seat of her car. It turned out to be Brian. Brian ripped the phone from her hands and an argument ensued. And in order to make her comply, Brian took out a gun. Denise eventually was able to pull into a CVS parking lot and was also able to talk Brian out of his plans, driving him back to his truck and promising not to tell police what he had done. Of course, as soon as he left, she went straight to the police. And after a lengthy court process in December 2017, Brian Winchester was sentenced to 20 years in prison for his actions, with 502 days credited as time served. It seemed that at the end of the day, Denise had been able to get rid of two husbands. But wait, Mike's body had just been found, just over a month prior. So now investigators had one suspect already in jail, who probably had more than enough reason to testify against Denise. And on May 8th, 2018, Denise Williams was arrested at Florida State as she left work to celebrate her daughter's birthday. The trial itself? Absolutely eventful. Denise's lawyer said that his client was innocent of all charges. She had nothing to do with Mike's disappearance, or the three life insurance policies, and had nothing to do with all of the crimes that Brian Winchester had committed. They also found it convenient that the indictment came after Winchester, Brian, had been imprisoned for several months, and on Denise's behalf, they entered a plea of not guilty. And only a month later, Denise was ordered held without bond. And in September, audio of Brian's interview with the Florida Department of Law Enforcement would be played in court, where Brian confessed to doing the deed, but claimed that it had been Denise's idea. Denise's lawyers would argue that the tape shouldn't be admitted as evidence, because Brian wasn't charged with anything despite his admission. Prosecution said they'd simply asked him what happened, and by December she was on trial. By February of 2019, after Brian confessed to everything, including their relationship that had snowballed from 1997 into what had happened to Mike in 2000, Denise found herself sentenced to life in prison, and the only person to address the court besides the lawyers was Cheryl Williams, Mike's mother, who said that Denise had not only taken her son from her, but also her grandchildren. And this case is still playing out today. In January of 2020, Denise Williams appealed her conviction and life sentence. Her attorney argued before the Florida First District Court of Appeals that there was no evidence that she had been involved in Mike's disappearance and subsequent death. So, we look forward to updating this one.
If you've made it this far, thank you for listening, and please consider checking out some of the many other true crime videos on my channel. Please don't forget to both subscribe and click the notification bell so that you can be notified every time I upload a new video. I'm Jason Hebert, and I'll see you next time.